The Copenhagen Zoo is defending its decision. Joining us now on the line is the zoo's scientific director, Bengt Holst. Thanks so much for talking with us. People love giraffes. Children love giraffes. Why put the giraffe down just to keep it from breeding?
Because it's part of a breeding program, and there is actually no space for him in the breeding program. That means that his genetic composition doesn't fit the other animals in the program. And when they breed well, you will reach this ceiling at some stage. And this is the place where we are right now. So we do have a surplus, and this surplus cannot fit with the other ones in the program. So that's why.
Why not sterilize the giraffe? Why not pen him away from other giraffes? Why not take whatever measures you could to keep him alive?
Well, if we just sterilize him, he will still take up space for the genetically more valuable giraffes. And the breeding program has the purpose of ensuring a healthy population far into the future. And if that is all space filled up with animals not fit for contributing to this healthy population, then it's not worth anything. So we have to make sure that the giraffes are all genetically valuable, and this was not.
Now, you're talking about this like a scientist, which is appropriate, but it sounds so cold, so mercenary, and presumably you, like so many people who work at zoos, love animals. Why not find another home for the giraffe in another zoo? Or I gather the Copenhagen Zoo was offered a lot of money by a private individual who offered to take Maris.
Well, I mean, this is not a Copenhagen Zoo program. This is a European program. So really all the zoos participating in this program, they were actually part of this analysis where we tried to fit the various pieces in the puzzle, and there was no space for him. And then, of course, we could just send it to some other zoos outside the program. But if these zoos, they don't work according to the same ethical values that we have and the same ways of managing animal populations, then we don't want to send them just to get rid of it. They have to make sure, for example, that they don't sell animals. I mean, we don't want to sell animals. And if you have a good breeding program, you should make sure that
But you'd rather kill animals than sell them? It just jumps out. And we're looking at pictures here of people actually looking at the dead giraffe. I gather the giraffe was actually, it was butchered or dismembered so that other animals could eat it. That also was done in front of zoo visitors. It just seems cold.
Yeah, that's because all animals dying in the zoo, they will go through an autopsy. And you know why we have these autopsies. And in this case where this has to be done in the open because it's such a big animal, we just as well use the opportunity and invite our guests to see how fantastic a giraffe is inside, how big a heart they have, that they have seven neck vertebrates just like you and I have, et cetera, et cetera. So our vets do not only dissecting it, but also telling about the wonder of the giraffe. So that's a question of educating, and that's the purpose of the zoo, to educate people.
Were you there that day? I'm just wondering how many children left the zoo in tears, traumatized by what the adults had done to this beautiful animal.
None so ever. There were a lot of people. They could choose if they want to see it or not, because it was in the place where public normally not have any access. But they were really very enthusiastic, asked a lot of questions, especially the kids asked questions and got good answers. So they get home with much more knowledge about giraffes that they entered the zoo with.
Now, we are grateful that you're taking the time to explain this to us, and you've talked to journalists dispassionately and very professionally about your work, but do you understand why people are just mystified and shocked?
Well, I don't
people
know.
Relate to this on an emotional level. You must understand. You help run a zoo.
Yeah, well, I understand. I understand that people get mystified, because that's actually a scary thing, because people get so far away from nature that some people think that nature is only the what I call the Disney world, where everything is so nice and animals only get born, they never die. And that's wrong, of course. We have to tell the real story. If animals are born, they will also die at some stage. And this story has to be told. And that's one of the ways we can tell the story and tell people that this is part of life.
It's not a part of life most people encounter at the zoo. You're right about that. How many other animals does the Copenhagen Zoo routinely put down who are otherwise healthy?
How many we euthanize like this, call
yes.
like this?
Yes. Is it happening a lot?
Yeah, well, it's difficult to say. And on average over the past 10 years, it's probably around 20, 30 a year, something like that. I mean, that's for goats and antelopes, etc. And then, of course, the meat is used for the carnivore feeding.
Did you ever expect that there would be this much controversy about Marius the giraffe?
No, I think this is totally out. I mean, this is totally out of order, out of proportion that we've had so much attention for this, because this is actually nothing else that every country is doing with their wildlife. I mean, you call white-tailed deer probably in the U.S., and we call roe deer in Denmark, and the U.K. people call the rabbits, etc., in order to match the populations of these animals to the surroundings, and that has to be done. And that's the same situation we have in zoos. We have a special limited amount of space, and we have to adapt the population to this space and make sure that the animals are the best ones to be in this space and not hybrids, etc.
Bengt Holst of the Copenhagen Zoo, thank you so much for talking with us.
You're welcome.